and I hope you learn from it and enjoy it. This is very much the beginning of a road for you, thinking about the future and thinking about how to prepare yourself for an ever-changing world. We're very lucky today. We've got some wonderful, inspirational women coming to talk to you, and I'm just going to briefly introduce them before I hand over to Ruth, who's going to start us off. And they're going to share some of their wisdom and tips with you and give you some information that you can take away and that will help you as you prepare for the future. It might seem a long way away to you, but it is important to start understanding that the things that you do now can affect what you can do later. And we're going to be covering a wide range of things. You're going to be doing, I think I've worked out, something like 80,000 hours of work in your career. You're likely to be working until you're at least 70. So it's really important that you make the right decisions and that you really think carefully at this stage. So starting your thinking now, but not narrowing you down and wanting to think as broadly as possible is a sort of key thing that I want to make you think of. Right, so I'm now going to introduce our guests. And the first guest who's going to be speaking in a minute is Ruth. Ruth Foridamizo. Ruth is actually going to, I think, give you a little bit of background to herself in a minute, but I'll just give a very quick overview. She graduated from the University of Durham in sociology. She's got a master's from the LSE. And after university, she's worked in a variety of industries. She's also is the founder and director of something called the Cultivate Cloud. And I'm looking forward to hearing more about what that is and the Achieve program that you've worked hard to set up. And it's very much cultivating the potential of young people. And I've noticed on your blog, like yourself, in your spare time, Ruth enjoys watching Marvel movies, video editing, and travelling into various cultures, exploring cultures. So a little bit of a feel for Ruth, and we'll find out more about her in a minute. And she's going to start us off with a short, very inspiring talk. I'm going to hand over to Ruth.
Morning, girls. I actually met Karen at an event a couple of months ago, that's how I ended up here, but I'll give you more to my background in a minute. Who am I? So I'm in this group of my events, as I said earlier, and I spent a lot of time talking, but I spent a little bit of time talking about my background. So I'm currently 23 years of age, so to be here is a little bit wild, because I'm just thinking I was here like 5 or 6 years ago in your position, thinking about what I'm going to be doing, and thinking about my future steps, which is why I've been in so many different industries. I feel like it's very difficult to decide this is what I'm going to do for like the next 70 years of my life, but I still feel like I'll probably change a few more things in terms of jobs, but it's really interesting to kind of think about what you want to do in the future. My educational background, we'll talk about it a little bit, I'll go into more depth, but I went to Durham University, and then after I went to the LSE, so I feel like that's added a lot of value to my educational experience. I work for a company called Interim Partners, so I've been working there for the past 6 months. It's probably the 12th job I've had in my career. I did a lot of short-term interim work, so working in the company for like 3 months, seeing if I liked it and move on to the next, which I hear is a very manual thing to do, but I feel like it has shaped the way that I see the world of work. And lastly, the Cultivate Cloud. So this is the company that I started when I was 21 years of age, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in a little bit later. So, where did it all start? So, I went to Greenshaw. Does anyone know Greenshaw? It's literally down the road, so I lived too far from here. And I went to Greenshaw there for 5 years, and I really, really enjoyed it. And when I left with 6 A's and 5 B's, which I thought was a pretty good start. But then, I did my A-levels, and I think reality hit me another way. So when I finished my first year, after getting my 6 A's and 5 B's, I mentioned that, I finished on a U, an E, and a D. Okay, so imagine going from A's and B's to a D, an E, and a U. And we all know that it's going to be a happy ending, because I said I went to Durham and LSE, so you know, it's not too scary, but it was a really, really difficult time for me. Because I was like, I thought that I was smart, I thought I was working hard, so how did I go from something I thought I needed really, really well to ending really, really badly? So I was taking subjects as I need. I went to Archbishop Tennyson's for sixth form. I studied mathematics, which is probably the bane of my life. Also studied sociology, religious studies, and economics. So I did those four subjects because I wanted to pick two writing subjects and two numbers, like numerical subjects, so I could have a good balance in terms of what aspects I wanted to do at university. So after I got these grades that hit me with reality, I decided to take time to actually invest in my educational, I'd say, future is probably the best way to say it. So something that really, really helped me was teachers. So a lot of times, I feel like teachers are like a hidden resource to use at school. They know how it works. They've done it for many, many years. They know which websites the resources are at. They are always, well, I say always free, but they're always free in the sense that you can see them before or after school in your breaks. So it's not like you have to go and travel to find them. They're already there. So I decided to just badger my teachers, ask them what I could do better, ask for specific feedback in terms of what I could do to improve. I would write extra questions, I would give it to them, ask them to mark it in their spare time, and this really, really helped me. At the same time, I knew that I was going to university, or I aspired to go to university the next year. So what I decided to do was make a lot of friends. So I socialised a lot in that time, but when I came home, I'd work 10 times harder. I also badged my parents for a tutor. So when I was doing A-level maths, I had two tutors, and they would come 3 times a week. So one would come twice a week, and one would come once a week, because I was really, really struggling with maths. That's where the U came from, by the way, if you're wondering. It came from you, I'm really bad at maths, so I had to decide that was not a good look for me. I also planned my study. So what I would do is every Sunday, for about an hour, I'd see which subjects I needed to work on more for 1 week, and which subjects could kind of take a backseat for that particular week. And that really helped me think about how I could space my time, and how I can also go out and still socialise. So I don't really believe in just studying all the time, because then you get like mind blocks, and then when you take a break, it's very, very long. I mean, I've watched like 5 good episodes in a row on Netflix, which then turns to 10, which then turns to a season, which is not going to help anyone. So I decided that, you know what, I need to really plan for my revision. So after that, made it to university, I actually ended up getting, in my A-levels, I got A star AC. So going from DEU to A star AC was a big achievement for me. I made it to Durham University. I studied in St. Cuthbert's College, if anyone knows it. And I studied sociology, and I stayed for 3 years. After that, went to LSC, went back to live at home in the comfort of mum and dad, which was great. I'm still enjoying it now. Getting 3 meals a day, cooked for me, getting my washing done, and it was such a contrast with being at Durham University, which was so far. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about my university experience, a little bit more depth for you. So, I was at Durham for 3 years. This is me at my graduation. They give you fur, which is really great because Durham is too cold. So the fur really does. It's not just for fashion, it's actually very needed. So, I was 300 miles away from home, which is very, very far, and it's very expensive to get home. So it was a time that really built independence in me. So a lot of times people go to university to study for a degree, which is fine, study for a subject that they love, also fine. But I'm going to talk about why specifically, or what specifically I learned from Durham University, because I got my degree, which I absolutely love. I love sociology. I love the way it developed me. But I also think that it's taught me other things that are equally as important. So one of the things that it taught me was making friends with people from different cultures. So it was very diverse. I met people, my housemates were actually not from London. So everyone I lived with for the 5 years, the five people I lived with for the 3 years I was there, none of them were from London. So one lived in Newcastle, one lived in Ireland, one lived in Wales, and the other lived in Manchester. So it was really, really diverse. And I've never, at this point, I've been to Ireland, and now I go every year to see my friend, or we go on holiday together. So that's really nice. This year I'm going to Prague, so I have high expectations for that. So it really opened me up to meet from different cultures and different people that I hadn't really spoken to, and it allowed me to travel. When you only have to pay for your flight to Ireland, you can go as many times as you want. Family will have you with open arms. It also made me very, very resilient. So living away from home was really difficult for me at first because I was so used to living at home, so used to being close to my family. And you just kind of go from the comfort of home to just being very, very isolated. But it also built resilience in me. It made me very independent. And it also made me realise I knew what I stood for. So at university, a lot of people maybe have debates about you, about why do you believe what you believe, or what your work ethic is like. Nobody's knocking on my door to be able to go to lectures. You can build that independence in yourself. And that really, really helped me to decide that this is something that I wanted to do. So it made me very focused as well. After all of that, it also got me a degree. So I'm really very grateful for that. So I feel like university taught me so much about the possibilities of the things that I wanted to do. I believe you can definitely do things outside of university, but I love studying. Like, I would study for fun. I would do a PhD when I get the time. Like, I love that idea of studying and always being thirsty for knowledge. So that's something that really was built to me. After I got this, I decided that I wasn't too sure what I wanted to do after university. You have a lot of options after 3 years. You can go into work, you can decide to travel, or you can study some more. So I decided to study some more. This is me and my master's. A picture of it, so everyone knows that room. And that was really interesting. So I studied at the LSE for 1 year. I studied something called contemporary social thought. Does anyone want to guess what contemporary social thought is about? Why do people think the way they do, or what areas they think about? We did talk about the media, we also talked about cities, we also talked about money, we talked about everything that's happening in contemporary society, we talked about war, we talked about things that are relevant here and now. And that's really helped me in my job now, which I'll explain. So I'll get to that part in a minute. But at LSE, I was able to study this for 1 year with 6 modules, so 6 different subjects, intensely. How much money to get a degree in bus stops? Have an interesting story. So how many of you have ever been on a bus? Okay. How many of you have ever waited for a bus at a bus stop? How many of you have sat on a bus stop? How many of you think that it's comfortable? How many of you think saying waiting for a bus is comfortable? Okay. No one says it's comfortable. Why is it not comfortable? It's hard. You can't really fit on it. They're slanted.
And I'm like, my pants are worn, it's like football.
Yeah, that happens to me. I have my pants a little bit short as well. It happened to me, my legs kind of went dangling and I was kind of slipping. Does anyone know why it's designed like that? Yes, so the reason why it's designed, bus stop is designed like this is so that homeless people don't actually sleep on it. It's designed like that to be very exclusive. Exclusive in the sense that you're only waiting for a bus. And even when you're waiting for it, you're not that comfortable. So they design it in such a way to keep homeless people away and keep just the people waiting for the bus for it. If anyone's ever been to Beers Land in Soho or Charing Cross, someone ever been around that area? If you see the ground outside the theatres, when the theatres close, they put spikes in the ground, so they lay out spikes. I don't know if anyone's ever been to Charing Cross, but there's a lot of homelessness there. And they do that as a deterrent to keep people from sleeping in the doorways. Some law firms have it as well on the floor. So cities are designed be very exclusive, and that's something that we looked at in my degree. So why is cities designed to do that? Why do they want to push people out of society? Does anyone know what this is? Yeah. You can shout out.
Bitcoin.
Yeah. Has anyone owned Bitcoin? Has anyone held Bitcoin? Has anyone seen Bitcoin? Okay. So how do we know that this side is? No one's seen it, no one's touched it.
I saw it on my shelter panel.
Yeah? So you've seen it in the media? Is there anywhere else that anyone's seen it? No? So another point that we studied in my degree is we studied about money. And we studied why is money the value that it is? So you see this Bitcoin, we say that Bitcoin's worth a lot, Bitcoin's gone up, Bitcoin's gone down, but we've never actually held it. We never actually touched it. And something we studied was we only see money as worth something because we attribute value to it. So money is only valuable because we have determined that it's valuable. So it could be, this could be worth nothing, because we all believe collectively as a society that this is worth something, we have decided that Bitcoin, is worth value. So I'm going to do a quick illustration of this board, so in this class. Came out and I was thinking, okay, what's next for me? I've spent this studying this degree, meeting lots of exciting people, what's next? So this time I actually had to make a decision because studying a PhD for 5 or 6 years is very time-consuming. So I was thinking, let me actually explore the world of work. So, this is my improvement history. As you can see, it's very skewed. So I'll start with the right-hand side, which is your right. So, my first ever job was at Chessington Royal Adventures, which was an amazing experience. I got to try the lines every day to make sure it was safe for everyone to go on. I was actually a ride host, so I'm not sure if you've ever been to a theme park, but you know when the rides come in and someone's waving, like, hi! That was me. A year. Just a year of hi! So I've really got some of my high voice for YouTube, so that's really great. After that, I worked in Boots. I worked there for 5 years. So I worked there as I was studying at my sixth form. Studying in sixth form? It was a little overlap, I guess. And then I also studied there when I was doing my degree. This made me a big consumer of makeup and perfumes. I love all things smelling nice, all things liquidity. After that, I went back to my old school. They needed somebody there for a short amount of time. Ended up staying there for 7 months. The film was a one-off contract. I was there for 7 months. I also worked at Oasis Academy. I'm not sure if anyone knows Oasis Academy, the school. So I worked there as well for 3 months, doing some short-time work there as well. After that, when I was working at the school actually rented out their schoolhouse as an office. And there was this company, they were a startup firm, and they saw me on reception, and sometimes they would come speak to me because they worked next door. And from that, they were like, I really like you. We can use you in our business. So I actually became a relationship manager for them. So I ended up going to different schools and managing the relationships between themselves and clients. And I didn't apply for that job. In fact, I don't think I even put a CV in for that job. They literally just said, we really, really like you. And they just asked me to come and work there, which is why character and excellence is so important. You never know who's watching you. You never know who's seeing what you're capable of. You're never seeing like the potential you have because people are always watching. So that was a job I didn't have to apply for. After that, I worked in Inspire for a month, which is literally down the road. And another job that I haven't put on there, just to add to the list, is I worked at a consultancy firm for 3 months as an office manager, just helping them out while they had like clients going on at the same time, so I was there for a short time. So that was my previous history. And then on the left-hand side is everything I'm doing now. So I'm working currently at Interim Partners. They're a recruitment consultancy firm. I've been there for the past 6 months. It's actually my first permanent role. So I'm going to be there for a very long time. I decided to commit myself to a job and actually just work my way up and decide to take the skills that I have. Because I've had such a lot of experiences in employment, I've had a lot of experiences in different industries, and that seems to them to be really, really valuable. So I'm working there. And aside from that, I'm also a tutor. So I've been tutoring for the past 4 years in sociology. I love sociology so much, and I couldn't think of any other way I could legitimately still have interest in it except as a tutor. Because sometimes I do read like books about it, or sometimes I do watch TED Talks, but this allows me to still like keep up to date with what's going on, and I guess have a passion for it. Then I started the Cultivate Cloud. So I was 21 years old when I was in a school, and I heard some boys talking about how they feel like they weren't going to do very well in their exams. And then I just got talking to them, and I got really, I guess, frustrated, because a lot of the things that they were talking about were things that I had experienced. I had my U's and E's and D's to, you know, show for it. I was like, I'm really going to help other people be better than I have, or better than I have. So my very best, my ceiling, my highest achievements should be the very bottom for people at that age. So the things that I know at 23 years old should be what people know at your age, maybe 15 or 16, that should be the very top of what you know. So my ceiling should be somebody else's floor. That should be a starting point for people. And that's why I started my company. So I go to schools, I do workshops with different youth groups, I do different types of seminars or workshops based on the ideas or based on the experiences I've had in the hope that somebody else can have a better experience than me. Because as much as we're laughing and we're joking and we've been talking about things today, when I got my U's, I was very shocked and I didn't know what to do. I had to find out that knowledge for myself. So if somebody's keen and wants to know how to do better, I want to be able to facilitate them to do that. So this is what we do, have a lot of social media to try and promote ourselves, as well as doing things like this. So I want to leave you with 3 things I've learned, or 3 things that I can summarise my experiences as. The first one is know yourself. So because I knew that I liked education, I knew that I was ready to be independent. I knew I wanted to go to university. I knew I was ready to be away from home. Not everybody knows that at that time. And it's so easy, I think, when there's so much going on, not to really know who you are, know your values, and know what you stand for. So I think it's always important to know who you are. If you weren't at school, what would you want to do instead? If you were at university, what would you want to do? What do you want to pursue? What do you like doing in your spare time? That was something that I had to learn, I think, not until I got to university. So if you can know it now, great. Know knowledge. So I really believe in the pursuit of knowledge. I really believe in studying. I really believe just knowing things, like reading as many books as possible, looking into different TEDx talks or TED talks, looking into the knowledge that's available. Love a good YouTube video, like something to watch, something to challenge you. Stepping out of your comfort zone, not doing things the same. And the last one is no networks. I wouldn't be here today if I didn't go to an event to network with somebody. All the people that I've met at school, especially people in my inner circle, I still know now. I may not be as close to them as I was at university, because I feel like university is a bit of a bubble, so you see the same people every day. But I keep my networks, and I still speak to a lot of people that I speak to. The people in this room could be the people that you work with in the future. And I know people laugh about it, but I remember I was sending an email to somebody at work, and the person who responded, I actually went to a bridge with her, and I was emailing her. She goes, did you go to bridge? I was like, yeah. And she had LinkedIn, and we were just talking about how crazy it was that our two companies are now doing business with each other, and now we're like negotiating the deals, which is really, really interesting. So your networks are your network, people say that. I believe there's some truth in that. Even if people aren't in the industry that you want to be in, so for example, you might be interested in education, somebody might be an engineer, you might not see the link, there might be a link there someday, so it's definitely worth keeping your networks. So, I've left some time for questions. I know after a big talk, you're like, sometimes people are like, I don't really want to ask questions, but to make it worth your while, I've got these packs. In these packs, you've got a notepad. I mean, you can't see it, but on the way. You have a notepad, you have a pen, you have some revision tips, and you have some sweets. So if you want to ask a question, I think I have a couple of them to give out. So you're welcome to ask me questions about my educational history, my employment history, or anything in between.
When you got your grades, how did you change your mindset to that? What did you do to change your grades?
That's a good question.
Everyone gets one.
Yes, I know you got one. What did I do to change my mindset? For me, when I got the grades, it really threw me off because I wasn't expecting to get such grades, especially because I like to work hard and I like to study. So I had to be more intentional with my studying. That's the only way I think I can describe it. It's about being intentional, about thinking about what I actually wanted to get from this. And that's why I said it's important to know yourself, because I know I wanted to go to university to do something, but I just didn't know what I wanted to do. So I decided to take that time to plan my revision, think about sometimes it means not going to a motive. There's something called embark study, I'm not sure if you know it. It's talking about the visual way you study, the audio way, is like reading, and the K is kinetics, and doing case studies. So I think everybody's way of studying is very unique. The way that people choose to study differs from person to person. And for me, I am very much a reader, so I can make like 100 pages of notes, or about maybe 50 pages of notes, and condense it down to maybe 2 pages, and condense it down to a spider diagram, because the repetition of reading and writing actually makes me remember. So it differs from person to person, but I do think that everyone has a specific way. So a lot of people might want to watch like a case study or watch maybe a video to learn. So I think there's quizzes online, and I think they're pretty accurate, because I've done that quite a few. And I feel like it really does shape the way that I revise. I'm going to pick one from each side of the code. Really? Durham University was good. One of the biggest mistakes I made was not actually going to see it beforehand. So I didn't, I know you look surprised. I went to so many other unis, but I didn't go to Durham to look at it because it was so far. When I applied, I was applying in faith, so I clicked open application. I didn't actually check which college. These are little mistakes that could really I think shape your experience. Definitely go and see university before you apply, don't do what I did, and definitely check out the college, because it was worth it for me to actually find out what I wanted to do and how I wanted to proceed. So I'm just going to lift this up. How do I not become stressed? That's a very good question. How do I not become stressed? I think it was prioritising my time. That was definitely helping. And I also spoke to my parents. So sometimes they were like, I don't know, I feel like sometimes, not be inconsiderate, but I think lose what was going on. Sometimes they'll maybe be watching the news when I'm trying to study, or they'll be asking me to like wash the dishes. It's not really helpful. Like, I was like to them, I don't think this is going to help me with my studying. So once I made them aware of my surroundings, that really helped. Three extra points I just want to add in terms of revising and not getting stressed is, when you're revising, three things that's helped me in terms of how I revise is location, so where do I revise? Links, who do I revise with? So sometimes I revise by myself, sometimes it's better to revise with lots of people. And sometimes also thinking about what materials do I need, so how do I learn? So sometimes it might be I need a laptop to do what I'm doing, sometimes I can just do it by myself with notes. So I think if you think about how you actually want to revise and what you want to get out of it, that will keep you calm. Because when you think about all the revision you have to do, it's very overwhelming. That's not going to help you when it comes to actually studying. Does that make sense?
So you may get to lots of different jobs. Do you think that improves your knowledge and experience just in general?
Definitely, because when I apply for this job, which is permanent now, they were saying that you've been to a lot of different industries, so you'll know how to deal with a lot of situations, and they did ask me like really, really good questions. And I think it did bring a wealth of experience. I think because as well I'm quite young, I still live at home, I have the ability to do this, not everyone does. So when you're young, you can change jobs, it's okay, because I'm still living at home, I'm not paying rent, I don't have a mortgage at this moment in time. So everything's quite settled if you decide to make changes. So I think it's really important to think about what position you actually are to do this. Some people know that they want to be an engineer, so they won't be changing lots of jobs like I am. Not all of my friends have done that. Because I was trying to find out which path was best, I had the freedom to be able to make those changes. So you're quite far. I have a mark for a long time, so I'll just keep going until I'm not
in the middle.
Straight away. So if I was to say that I definitely wanted to study sociology, that would be a lie because it was a journey. What I decided to do is, at the end of first year, when I got my grades, I had to consider where this was going, because it wasn't really going where I wanted it to go, especially considering I was doing so well previously. So something I looked at is, what am I good at and what do I enjoy? So I was very good at sociology and I also enjoyed it. I wanted to actually pursue, funny this now, economics. So I actually wrote my personal statement for economics. And then I was thinking about it realistically, I wasn't doing that well. So I wrote another personal statement for economics and sociology. After I wrote that, I was like, this is not realistic at all, because I was really like passionate about the sociology side, but when it came to economics and talking about why I wanted to study it, it kind of fell flat. So then I decided just sociology. And I feel like it's not too narrowing. So with sociology, you can go into medium, you can go into teaching. It was very diverse, and for that, that's why I was serious. So I think it's also taking a look at what you actually want to enjoy and what industry you want to go into. And I have nothing against gap years. I feel like that year I was working in different industries was as close to a gap year as I'll probably get, because I was able to do different things and still travel and anyway. Sorry. That's really good. I'm out of packs, but I also have pens, so that works well. Capital. So I see myself in 5 years' time. So honestly, I want to go into project managing and go into consulting. So consulting for businesses, consulting in terms of leadership and management and how they can work better. But I also want to consult in terms of education. So I always want to personalise the way that people study or personalise the way that people think about what they want to do. So rather than following the masses, what do you as yourself want to do? So I definitely want to go into that space, and that's something that I hope to do in this role, so hopefully very into project management consulting and splitting my time between work here and working outside work. This is still work, it's just outside work. That's what you're doing. Definitely, because everyone says that A levels is a big jump. It's a bigger jump than I expected. I didn't expect it to be as challenging or as difficult. And bearing in mind, I went to a different sixth form, so the teachers didn't know me, they didn't know my ability, they didn't know how to support me. And in hindsight, that's something I would have considered. But I was just thinking, oh my gosh, it's been 5 years of experience, what can I get from this next place? And I think that time I wasn't really thinking about how is this actually going to affect my education or affect what I want to do or where I'm thinking. So I did get very complacent. But I think I woke up after that experience of not doing as well as I wanted to do. And ever since then, I've never had to be in that situation where I've had to be quick to study. So with my when I finished my time at Durham, I finished with 2-1, I was happy with that, although I was the first, but you know, 2-1 works. And then when I finished my master's, I also finished on a merit. So it was never like I was underachieving and I felt like I had to work harder again. From that one experience, it's like, yeah, I'll never be complacent again. But I think that's also part of my character as well. That's your question? So the initial idea was something that I was passionate about, but passion doesn't pay bills. Passion does not pay bills, guys. So I had to think about how I actually wanted to sort of proceed with what I was doing. So in the first year, I started a crowdfunding page. I got over £1,000. A lot of people are passionate about students' education. So a lot of people donated, and a lot of people volunteered, and even like Stacey coming today to do photography, coming as a volunteer. People choose to buy into the vision they're passionate about, because they just want something to do well. So that's how I started. After that, I went to a few speaking competitions, won money from that. Also won an opportunity to go to the House of Lords and have dinner with the Lord and share my idea. I got mentoring and coaching for it. So as long as you're passionate about it, things will come to you, because people always want to see an idea grow. They want to see somebody like push for what they want, and that really helped me in what I wanted to do, because even when I was tired or even when things weren't going as I wanted, passion still kept me going, but it's not sustainable. So you're going to need other resources to keep going. Are you okay for time, sir? 5 minutes. So I think about 3 questions, if that's okay. I'll go to people at the back.
How did you manage to see the pocket from the drawing?
So, how did I receive? I actually got all 5 offers from all 5 universities that I applied to. How did I do that? I have very good writing skills. But apart from that, I also took good retakes. So, now you don't take retakes until the next year, but before then you can take a retake in January. So I retook in January, got my grades up a little bit better. They weren't where I wanted them to be, they were still like B, C, D. And then from that, I just convinced the teachers that I was willing to work hard. And because I was seeing them outside of office times, I was asking them questions, I also told them that I had a tutor as well. They saw that I was going to be serious about it. So the reference that I wrote was actually, I still have it now, it was actually really, really good. They wrote a really, really good reference saying that you can work hard if you take her. So that's why I said teachers are such a great resource. Because I explained to them, I don't know what happened in the first year, and I know I'm new to this school, you don't know me, but you need to help me get to the university I need to get to. And that's how I did it. And then when I got the grades, then it was fine for me to get to Durham, because I got what they wanted me to get. Sorry. That's fine. So I took the standard maths, English, science, but the additional subjects was additional science. I took history, I took business, food technology, and then ITRS. Because my school only let you pick 4, and the other 6 were compulsory. So compulsory subjects would be like PE, half of RS, but I took double. Does that make sense? Any second question?
What were your regrets in choosing this?
I wish that somebody was going to tell me what A levels were like. So even if they told me what was in the syllabus, that would have been very helpful. The only reason why I studied sociology is because I had a teacher at Bushel who said, oh, I think you'd really like sociology. That's literally the only thing he said. And I was like, you know what, I'm definitely going to do it. Because the teacher I knew very well. So he was a history teacher. And I saw him a couple of years ago. I said, I'm studying sociology because of literally what he said. So it's always important that your teacher knows you, which is why I would like to maybe change your schools, because the teachers didn't know me as much, so they couldn't really advise me when I wasn't doing well, to that they didn't know why. So that was very difficult for me to understand why it wasn't going the way that it was going. And I'll take one last question.
Did your revision techniques like change much when you went to Durham, or was it sort of like, did it still stay the same?
I think it stayed the same, but more intense. So it was, I feel like you're doing six different modules, but you're doing it for all the same subjects. So sociology has a lot of overlap. So even though I may be studying something that's in crime, which may be different to society, there's still overlap. So I think it's a very holistic view. So I couldn't compartmentalise my revision to do this subject for this and that subject for that. I had to be very holistic with it. And I think at university as well, I spoke to more friends. So usually I would revise alone. Because everyone's in the same situation, I was revising a lot in groups, literally living in the library, sometimes there for 3 days, literally like there. That's how intense it was for me, because I was just like, I need to do well. And that's very much my mindset. Thank you very much.
Tables at the back, and I want you to go and stand around the table, and I want one